Hello, everyone. My name is David Malin, and I'm so sorry I couldn't be there in person with you this week, but I'm here to present on behalf of myself, Brian Yu, and Doug Lloyd from CS50 at Harvard. If at any point during today's talk you have any questions or after the talk, please feel free to drop me a note. I'll keep an eye on my email throughout the day. And if you'd like to get a copy of the paper in question, head over now or later to cs50.ly/sigcc20-paper, or for these very slides, you can go to cs50.ly/sigcc20-slides. So without further ado, CS50 is our introductory course in computer science for majors and non-majors at Harvard. It's a one-semester amalgam of courses generally known elsewhere as CS1 and CS2. We teach it primarily in C, followed by Python. And as of the past few years, CS50 happens to be Harvard's largest course with over 800 or so students on campus as well as online through Harvard's Extension School, two-thirds of whom have never taken a computer science course before. The workload itself is non-trivial, with most students spending 12-plus hours per week on the course's problem sets or programming projects. And in terms of the course's support structure, we have lectures once per week, followed by sections or recitations led by the course's teaching fellows or TFs, as well as tutorials and office hours held by all of the staff, which are one-on-one opportunities for help with those same problem sets. Now, within the course itself, we have different tracks, so to speak, for those less comfortable, those more comfortable, and those somewhere in between, whereby different demographics of students convene for different sections so that they are among like-minded and similarly experienced or inexperienced classmates. And even within the course's problem sets, do we tend to have different versions of problems for those less comfortable or more comfortable that students can choose between week by week, depending on the ceiling or floor that they would like to have ahead of them. So the course, in terms of academic honesty, has a long-standing and very detailed policy on academic honesty in the syllabus that defines what is reasonable and what is not. In fact, if you'd like to look at the full detail, feel free to head to cs50.ly/sigcc20-syllabus. But in essence, the syllabus allows and encourages students to collaborate, particularly in pseudocode and when it comes to the thought before their programs, but it does prescribe guardrails on what collaboration is ultimately allowed, insofar as ultimately we prescribe for all of the course's problem sets that students implement their programs largely on their own and write their own code. An exception to this is the course's final project at term's end, where they're free to collaborate with one or two classmates. But in essence, within the syllabus, we provide this heuristic that generally guides these guardrails for students. Quote unquote, when asking for help, you may show your code to others, but you may not view theirs. In other words, if two students, A and B, happen to be sitting next to each other at office hours or in their dorms or the like, and one of those students is struggling, it's fine for the other student who isn't struggling to look at the struggling student's screen and perhaps point out rhetorically or more explicitly what lines of code or bugs or syntax they might want to focus on. But it would be crossing the line if the student who's struggling outright looks at the code of another student. But again, see the syllabus for more precise guardrails as well. Even so, despite these constraints in the course's syllabus, we have the unfortunate distinction in CS50 of referring more students most every year to the university's honor council or disciplinary process as a result of students having crossed some line prescribed in the syllabus. How we know this is that we, like a lot of universities or intro courses, do run our students' submissions through software, be it eTect or Moss or some other such tool with which you might be familiar. And it outputs, as part of that process, any number of similarities that we then apply human eyes to. So just for context, in fall 2019, most recently, among our 800 or so students and our 10 or so problem sets, did we have some 6 million plus pairwise comparisons conducted by this automated software, out of which might come 1,200 seemingly worrisome matches side by side to submissions that look unduly the same, at which point we have a gauntlet of humans, either two or three pairs of eyes, that then iteratively review those matches and whittle it down to a more manageable list. For instance, we ended up with 116 matches after initial human review, and then myself and the course's most senior staff each week sit down and review those matches and decide collectively whether or not to send a case forward to Harvard's Honor Council or not. In this most recent fall semester, did we refer 38 students to the Honor Council, at which point we document the case, we write up the similarities, provide the samples of those submissions, and then it's an independent body, this Honor Council, that ultimately adjudicates the outcome. Now, in terms of what these cases involve, it generally involves students having based their code on someone else's, whether that someone else is on campus or perhaps some online solutions. In terms of the numbers, each semester, it's highly variable over the years, but it generally ranges between 0 and 10% of the class that we ultimately refer to Harvard's disciplinary body. From conversations with peer institutions, we gather, unfortunately, that this 0 to 10% is within range of other courses as well. But it's worth noting in our case, it seems to be trending upwards. And that's in part because of some of the interventions we'll present here today. But even so, it's been of interest to us, certainly over the years, and to the university to reduce the frequency of these acts of dishonesty themselves, students copying unduly some online or some on-campus source. So this paper, and in turn today's talk, is really a look at everything we've tried over the years. And the spoiler, unfortunately, is that nothing really has worked, at least more precisely, and nothing has worked in our case that has put a consistent downward pressure on the total number of cases. But even so, we do think a number of the interventions we've tried have been successful educationally, ultimately transforming what had historically been purely punitive processes into more teachable moments. So what have we considered and what have we tried? Well, it's often suggested here on campus and perhaps beyond that we simply change the course's problem sets each year, the programming assignments. Unfortunately, at least in our case, the homework assignments tend not to be as simple as problems that allow you to change the inputs and expect different outputs. They do tend to be programming projects unto themselves, so changing the problem sets would involve rewriting and coming up with brand new problem sets. And at least in my case, I actually find that over time our problem sets get better over time as I work out the kinks, fix bugs, address FAQs within the specifications themselves. And so we feel it would actually be a net negative for the sake of that smaller demographic of students simply to throw out problems that seem to be challenging a majority of students and working well overall, so we've generally shied away from changing problem sets for changing problem sets' sake, though they certainly do evolve by choice on our part over time. It's often been suggested too, why don't we just reweight the problem sets, make them worth much less in terms of a student's final grade to put downward pressure, therefore, on the pressure they might be putting on themselves, and also the effect that plagiarized work might have on a student's overall quantitative performance. Here too, we feel that that would be a disservice to the sheer amount of time that students are spending on these programming assignments. Indeed, it is largely the problem sets that characterize students' learning and hands-on experience throughout the class, and so I've never been comfortable, for instance, with the idea of instituting proctored exams or weighting the exams in the class much more heavily than that which the students are spending most of their time on in the first place. But we have tried communication. Each year have we spent more and more, sometimes less, but in general more and more time on communicating to students exactly what our expectations are in terms of academic honesty, reviewing past cases that have gotten some of their prior classmates in trouble, albeit anonymously, and sharing outright examples of code that we adjudicated to be too similar or indeed identical in some cases. And we even go so far as to point out examples of the kinds of things we, via software, are looking for. Variables whose names are somewhat transposed but are still in essence serving the same function. And certainly for multiple lines of code as well, do we point out similarities there as well. We've also focused on raising awareness. Some years ago, did we have the university's Dean of Undergraduate Education even come to one of our orientation meetings at term start to speak to students, not only about academic honesty more generally, but also about the course's own policies and his own experience and his colleagues' own experience with, unfortunately, the disciplinary process that all too often results at the end of a term. Also, by nature of our having referred so many students over the years to this honor council, has there generally been, in some years more than others, just more awareness on campus of classmates who have been disciplined in some way? And so we find that, in part, our numbers trending up and down depending on the year is a reaction to the past year's numbers of cases and students' awareness thereof. But we've also taken more software-based approaches. So built into, for instance, the course's software via which students submit their work nowadays is an explicit prompt to which they must answer yes or conversely no. And we ask them explicitly, quote unquote, keeping in mind the course's policy on academic honesty, are you sure you want to submit these files? The presumption being that even if a student has, unfortunately, crossed some line or made some poor judgment, they have this final chance before they submit their work and put their name on that work to say, no, this is not, in fact, my own. Unfortunately, all too often have students still typed in yes and submitted their work despite this final prompt here. But we've also added other prompts over the years to the course's homework assignments via forms that the students submit, a la Google Forms, whereby we have an opportunity to ask them not only short answer, code unrelated questions, but also checkboxes and the like that we require that they check. We, for instance, in almost every problem set, present students with a link to the course's academic honesty policy in the syllabus and ask them to check a box by requirement that they have read and the course's policy on academic honesty. And then later in the term, do we ask them a few other related questions as well to ensure that they're not just clicking. Unfortunately, this too does not seem to have had a measurable effect on students' behavior. But we've also focused in recent years on more human interventions, interventional conversations, so to speak, whereby when the senior staff and I are reviewing that week's submissions, if we notice that some pairs of submissions seem to be awfully similar and awfully close to suggestive that some line has been crossed, but it's not clear-cut evidence thereof, we might instead ask those students to come in for a conversation to better understand how it is they approach that week's problem set, how or how they didn't collaborate that particular week, and ultimately not to interrogate them toward an end of some punitive outcome, but rather just to understand that process and to help them better navigate the waters next time around. So the outcome of this process, these interventional conversations, really is guidance and suggestions for how they can better structure their time together if they're indeed working with some classmate in some reasonable way for the coming week's problem sets as well. But perhaps most impactful was one sentence that we introduced to the course's syllabus in 2014, a so-called regret clause. At the time, we realized, after years of reflection on data past, that all too often were students' transgressions the result of late-night panic, late-night stress, often well after midnight when they simply, under a looming deadline in our course or others, opted to make a poor decision, grabbing some code off the internet, copying from some friend with or without their knowledge, and submitting it as their own. And up until then, we didn't have a well-defined process for how a student might own up to that sort of late-night mistake. To be fair, there was no mechanism and process preventing such students from coming forward the next day and admitting they had crossed some line. But with the potential penalty so high, indeed the university might, as part of the disciplinary process, ask that they withdraw from the college for one or more terms, it's no surprised that no students really availed themselves of that explicit option, and so we opted in 2014 to make it more explicit, introducing this language into the course's syllabus. If you commit some act that is not reasonable, but bring it to the attention of the course's heads within 72 hours, the course may impose local sanctions that may include an unsatisfactory or failing grade for work submitted, but the course will not refer the matter for further disciplinary action, except in cases of repeated acts. In other words, we hypothesized that if we allowed students some 2-3 days, in our case, to come forward after some rest, after some sleep, after some reflection, after having crossed some line, that they may very well take us up on that offer, reach out to us before we had even noticed the transgression ourselves, and indeed turned a process that would have otherwise become purely punitive into, we'd hope, a teachable moment. Indeed, after these invocations of the regret clause, would we sit down, I or one of the senior staff, with the student to first and foremost understand what had happened. We would then typically zero the problem or problem sets in question, but quite explicitly assure the student that we then considered the matter behind us. But we also invited students to share with us any extenuating circumstances or stressors that indeed had been looming on them when they made that poor choice. And in fact, as a side effect of this regret clause, not only did we hopefully transform within the course a historically punitive process to more teachable moments and opportunities, it also came to light in some of these conversations that students were having particular troubles back home, or relationships with roommates or friends or the like, struggling in other classes or struggling with issues of mental health. And so in those cases, when a student brought forth those circumstances, well, could we then connect them all the more successfully than in years past with the appropriate support structures on campus, particularly in cases of mental health? And so it's those conversations that had previously never happened that were the byproduct of having introduced this clause. And that first year, some 19 students availed themselves of that clause, coming forward to me for heartfelt and, in a couple of cases, tearful conversations as to what had led them to that particular point, at which point we then would connect those students with the right resources on campus. The year after, in large part, we think, because of awareness of the policy's introduction, did some 26 students out of the course's student body avail themselves as well. After that, I suspect we weren't as strongly voiced in the class and beyond the class on the availability of this clause, particularly as the campus newspaper's attention dwindled after a couple of years of it in play. But in more recent years, with 11 and 8 students having availed themselves most recently of this particular clause, do I suspect we're more in a band of equilibrium. Indeed, it seems to correlate with just how vocal we are as to the availability of this particular clause. Now, the introduction of this regret clause was not without issue or concern early on. Indeed, insofar as the Honor Council at Harvard is intended to handle all cases centrally, there was concern in some circles, particularly within the Dean's office as well as the Honor Council itself, that we were effectively proposing to handle some of our situations internally. Now, to be fair, we were only proposing to handle those cases that students themselves brought forward and not the cases that we ourselves detected via our automated and human process. However, ultimately, assuaging folks' concerns was the introduction of one final clause to that sentence, which was except in cases of repeated acts. Indeed, if a student availed themselves of our clause but then made a second mistake despite that intervention, we did agree to inform the Honor Council lest that student be crossing similar lines in other classes as well. Now, there are other interventions we've tried over the years inspired by these clauses and others that were not so successful. In fact, we tried deploying 2 years ago a so-called brink clause as well to the courses and syllabus, inspired, in fact, by a conversation I had with Princeton's Christopher Moretti at a past SIGCSE, in fact, whereby this clause's design was meant to preemptively catch students before they cross some line and was meant therefore to be much more proactive than reactive. In this case, we asked students in formal language in the syllabus if they feel themselves late at night about to make some poor decision, Googling more than they should, copying and pasting more than they should, to close their laptop, to email us, then close their laptop, and we'll deal with it in the morning, effectively giving them a blanket extension for the day until we can handle things after they've had some rest. Unfortunately, among the students who invoked this particular clause, as best we could tell, it was almost always effectively to obtain for oneself a self-granted extension. In few, if any, cases did we actually sense, based on the wording of the students' emails and subsequent conversations, that they were indeed, ironically, on the brink of doing something dishonest. And so we actually discontinued this clause last year as a result of those impressions. But we also have tried deploying even changes to some of the problem sets. And in fact, a few years ago, did we introduce a problem set on document similarity, ostensibly about plagiarism, whereby we challenged students to implement code that cross-compared two files and then visualized as by highlighting the similarities or differences between the two. Very similar in spirit to the software we ourselves use, but without describing it as a problem set on plagiarism. And yet somehow, as of 2018, when we last offered that problem set, did we end up referring six students to the university's Honor Council for having crossed some line on that particular problem set. Now, in terms of the results, our cases have indeed varied between 0% and 10% of the course's student bodies over the past 10 or so years. Most recently, in 2019, did we refer 5% of the course's student body to the Honor Council, even despite any number of these interventions in place throughout the semester. You'll notice, though, some curiosities. For instance, in 2016, a spike to 10% of the course's student body that actually follows 2 years later the course's regret clause. And this is not the result of, I think, any change fundamentally in students' behavior, though there does tend to be ebb and flow over the years based on, again, just how much awareness there is in a prior year of students and their classmates having been disciplined through this process that partly explains the upticks and downticks. But after 2014, truth be told, did we and did I personally become all the more comfortable referring students to the university's Honor Council simply because we had, after 2014, offered them this window of opportunity to come forward to meet us halfway via the course's regret clause. And therefore, in more recent years, have I been much more comfortable when presented with seemingly clear-cut evidence of simply documenting the case, referring it to the Honor Council, because the students have indeed had an opportunity to handle it otherwise. But that particular 10%, of course, was then noticed all in many circles on campus by way of the campus's newspaper as well. And so we think there, too, the 4% in 2017 was at least in part a reaction to students' awareness of just how seriously the course and others take these processes on campus. So if you'd like to learn more about this intervention in particular, I would invite you to take a look at the specific language in the syllabus, here again at cs50.ly/sigcsee20-syllabus. If you'd like to take a look at the paper or slides, here are those other two URLs again. And by all means, if you would like to experiment with the software we use, please feel free to take a look at this GitHub repository at github.com/cs50/compare50. This is CS50's own implementation of a tool similar in spirit to Moss or eTector, but in this case is the repository open source, is the design of the software meant to be extensible so that others can contribute heuristics and algorithms and variations thereof. So by all means, please feel free to consider this part of the open source community now as well. If you do have any questions whatsoever, now or hereafter, please feel free to reach out. And on behalf of myself, Brian, and Doug, this was CS50.